going to take you with me to something which is called the single goods package. And single goods package has nothing to do with a single good in a package that you're going to ship somewhere. It's a package, legal package, European legal package, around non-food consumer goods. So it's a framework. And the European Union is going to step up the efforts against non-compliant consumer goods. And it's interesting, even if you ship one-to-one as a factory or fulfillment by Amazon, or since a few weeks possible, fulfillment by eBay directly to European consumers, it's going to have impact on everybody that supplies goods to Europe. The current framework is called New Legislative Framework. And in that framework, everything is arranged. Role for an importer, a role for a brand owner, a role for a distributor. Retail and e-tail is called distributor, so not confused with somebody that's shipping goods. Logistics service provider is not mentioned at all. And it's even arranging the responsibilities of market surveillance authorities. So it's a balance between you putting products on the market and authorities looking into that market. If you don't make rules for that game, then it's not fair. Everybody needs to know the rules of the game, right? Food contact materials are a complete world on their own. So if you buy cutlery or dishware, that's their own framework. It's similar, but it's different framework, but similar rules. So graphically, it looks like this. There is, of course, a factory, an OEM, or it could be OVM. And then you have goods shipping to consumers. But that factory is actually not mentioned in legislation at all. Because after all, a consumer is just buying a promise of a brand. One of the major changes in the last year is that in all the directives under this legislation, they write the word formal non-compliance. Formal non-compliance is simply if somebody in that supply chain does not have any papers that can prove this product comply with requirements, and there is a risk for the end user, then the government already can organize a recall, even if nothing happened in the market yet. That's strange. So I can get a recall, even if I don't have complaints? Yeah. Because the government, they don't want a gambling game. They want to have a certainty that what you are selling is actually compliant. They know there is variation. You know, if you sell 1 million pieces, they might not all be 1 million the same. It's consumer goods, there might be variation. But if you would sell baby feeding bottles, and you have no idea how it's made, what materials are used, would you feel that the government should act or not? And of course, for some tablecloth, the risk is different than for toys for small children. That's obvious. So in order to really get a recall like this, you really need to create a mess. But by writing it down, at least they have the legal tool to do an audit of a system and take action rather than wait for something to happen in the market to find a faulty product. And they must do that because look at this trade show. How much technology has gone into all these products. Tables have become chargers, or chargers have become tables. How can governments keep up with smart TVs? Smart furniture, smart clothing, they cannot. They need to start to ask companies about their structure rather than about the product, because it's not a problem if you really look very good to find products that are non-compliant, which is not a fair game, right? To understand the market, you always need to understand your competition. And in certain ways, sometimes your competition can be the government. They're also a party of the market. Understanding how they do the market surveillance will help you to analyze risk. After all, it's always about managing business risk. And this is one of the recent results by TUKAS. TUKAS is the Finnish market surveillance authorities. If you really are interested, there's 238 pages of documents listing all the market surveillance authorities in Europe. 238 different market surveillance authorities in Europe. Crazy. TUKAS is one of them. They collected a lot of products. And they collected them from brick and mortar and from e-commerce, and they're not good. They're really not good. And this is what governments see. Governments see actually what goes wrong, because that's their focus, and it's not getting better. And that has to do with the way we start to deal business, and it's much easier for consumers to buy products directly. And they have a different kind of way to approach business. They like the flavor, they like the look and feel of it, and they like the price. And cheap and cheerful might not be cheerful, but at least it's cheap. What? Not too loud. It's very loud. It's coming. It's coming. It's coming. Very cheerful. So, Brussels is looking at the market and sees more and more products coming on the market that actually are non-compliant. Some of them actually disturb the wireless communication or internet traffic, which can really have an influence on the whole street looking at television, right? They also feel in Brussels that the market surveillance authorities in the different countries are not working as they should. There's not enough budget, governments are cutting out on them and feel that's not good, and that creates not a level play field. It becomes easier to import a product in Spain than to import from Holland. So what they have decided is the single good package to also step off the efforts of the market surveillance authorities, and I'm going to take you with that. Just one idea, look at this. Something really people would tend to buy because it's nice to have, but if it creates an accident, we will be liable. So, sorry for this example of catch and go, but this is really a no-go. And you know the intended use of this product will create a situation where you cannot even look at the instruments of a car. Yeah? The question is, if you are a consumer using this, if you still have a car insurance, you might not, right? So it has impact, and intended use is really written in legislation. That makes it really, really complex. Not all use is to be considered as intended use. You know, if people really want to use a trampoline on skyscrapers roofs, then it's fine. And if you want to cut your pieces in the garden, I'm happy with that. There are some limits to stupidity and testosterone. But you need to look at it. A single goods package, it's a legislation. And it's written and it's completed, but not yet signed off completely. Brussels is okay with it. And the bet is that the different countries will be okay with it as well, because it will create jobs. It's about the economy. Level playing field means companies investing in quality and compliance will be getting rewarded, and not face competition of companies that are undermining it by price, by cutting out of good materials and proper chargers and other stuff, right? Three steps. First one is technical documentation. What they're going to do is they're going to create a kind of a fear. They will say the following. Every product needs to have information on the outside that can lead the market surveillance authorities to the one that has the compliance information. That makes sense. If you in a store, it has address next to a logo or a brand, so the authorities know this is the company that imported the goods or manufactured the goods, and I can reach them out for compliance. Okay. But what if this product is in a package shipped from China to a consumer in Europe? Well, it's in an envelope or a box, and it's wrapped up, and it has the DHL card on it, and there's shipping documents, and it says Power Bank. Okay, it says Power Bank, but who is responsible? I cannot see. The single good package is as follows. It says, we're going to make a register of products, and if the product becomes listed as high-risk product, I want to have this information to the technical file available also on shipping documents. So you are now in the power bank world, and you know that maybe tomorrow they could put power banks on this list, which means that on the outside of shipping documents, I need to be able to point the authorities, which is the customs office, to somebody that has a technical file. Any moment they can put any list or any product on that list. And you know that the lag time, if that happens, to prepare for such administrative process, that's not 1 week or 2 weeks, it's even 1 or 2 months. It might be half a year to set up a platform like that. What you see is that, that's what we know, just by 40 to 60 companies a week already, people start to prepare. They know that certain products might be high-risk products. I think that hoverboards might be on them as well. What will happen if the product is on the list and the custom office cannot find a way to the compliance documents owner? They will destroy the product. So you will buy, as a consumer, a product on Amazon, eBay, an internet website, and you will not get that product. Which means for you as a consumer, this route becomes unreliable. So we see that the main players in the market, like Amazon and eBay, are actually putting a lot of pressure on people that do fulfillment buy on their platforms to step up their efforts to start to prepare for this. But because although they are not the ones that are ultimately responsible, it is their brand and their website that will be hurt when people are buying goods but not getting goods. It's a regulation, not a directive. A regulation means the moment it's signed off, it's national law instance. A directive is something that in Europe every country can change. A regulation in Europe, the same moment it's signed off, is law in all the countries. So they want to make the flow of the products more transparent. They want to be able to enforce access to documentation. They want to make the roles of the supply chain partners clear, also for packages shipped to consumers the moment those goods become on the list. And they don't need to pass a new law to put products on that list. That register is part of the law, and they can put any product on the list overnight. So if you are very good at products, but you know your competition isn't, no, you yourself, not necessarily the reason that your product category comes on that list. Just another event in the market can trigger that. Somebody start to dial 911 now. What's that noise in the living room? 15 seconds. Ah, 20 seconds. That's a good chair though. Runs like hell. I'll do it today. At least you've got a good fire extinguisher. What products are very likely to become high risk? Things that are generally cheap. This kind of Christmas lighting. A lot of price pressure in the market. Childcare products. Chargers. Power banks. Children like staircase protectors. Children walking aids. Laser pointers. Year on year, week on week, recalls. They're definitely going to be on that list. There will be no exception. You're not going to wait for that, right? It's not limited to products with a CE mark. You know, it could be clothing like children apparel. They will monitor the situation in the market. They can adapt instantly. And that is hovering over the market, and it's forcing supply chain partners to become more organized, all right? Access, how? It's you can put a telephone number on that, but you know, it makes more sense from logistic service providers to start to work with things like a QR code. And in Prototype B, we already have a QR code for each file which you can activate. Do you need to share all the documents? No, you need to share your CE declaration or your compliance declaration, probably contact details. You need to give the authorities some confidence. And I can also foresee that it becomes like an automated process. What does it mean for you? Well, ask yourself the question, if tomorrow some of the authorities call me, in a regular case, and say, can you supply compliance documents? Can you? If not, how long will it take? And how long will it take substantially if it's coming to you every day? How long will it take if it's not there for your supplier to prepare? It will probably take months. Second one, you know, it's not only bad stuff. There's still a lot of regulations in Europe that is different for countries, which is unfair. You know, there's like a leather regulation in Holland. I didn't know that the gravity in Holland is different. I'm 52 years old, but I think it's still the same as 15 kilometers to the east where Germany starts from where I live. It's unfair. You know, on one end we have European law, which is based on free trade of goods and services and products. And then there are still like national deviations on certain products. Brussels says the following: if you're selling a product in one country and it complies with national legislation in that country, and you have questions asked from another market surveillance authorities in another country, which is fair, and you give them the evidence. So I'll give the evidence of the Dutch letter compliance something to the German authorities, and they say, I don't accept it. At that moment you have a case, because you have an issue, you cannot sell the product. You notify that case at Brussels, and you continue selling. And Brussels will give the authorities 6 months to solve this case, otherwise they will solve it. There are certain cases where you can't. You know, England have a different plug than Italy. You cannot solve it. The gas feeding household appliances or cooking goods in Belgium is not the same as in Holland. Building regulations are not the same. But a lot of basic products are the same, and they will kill them. Brussels is stepping in. I think it's good news. You know, you have the case, but you continue to sell. It's good news. Solving it in 6 months is good news. It's about jobs. And it's interesting that Brussels is going to put a framework on national market surveillance authorities, because it's regulation. It's not a directive. The European countries cannot change it. Number three, single digital gateway to solve the problem. Why? If you are an SME, then start a new business, you need to know a lot of things about legislation. There's like labor law in different countries, and you need to have ventilation laws and access to handicapped toilets and food preparation laws. But there's also legislation on products which they feel that people that start a business or that expand their business need to get access to. So Brussels is going to step up the efforts to make this information available to people that want to sell products in different countries. Single digital gateway means like a single European Google, where you can post your questions and say, hey, listen up, want to sell t-shirts in Spain? Do I need to register somewhere? Or what is the emergency poison help desk telephone number in Austria, because I'm selling detergents in Austria, and I need to put that phone number on my product, because if something happens with a child in Austria, the parents or the doctor needs to be able to call the Australian poison help number. Very simple information, which is actually always there, but it's not always structured how to get there. So they want to set up a single digital gateway, especially for SMEs, to have access. You know, how to do my taxes in foreign countries, how to do shipping goods, how to do participate in a packaging directive requirement in some country. Single digital gateway to that, and might very well be that the information that Product IP has will become part of that. Nobody's talking about cost here. So it's not like we're going to put up a single digital gateway and you need to pay for that. It's all about jobs. The estimation is that it's 260,000 full-time jobs that they're losing out. It's substantial. Yeah. What you can do is, what we have already, is we have all that information in our database. It takes you about a minute to get European requirements and national deviations, and start to collect against the database with your supply chain partners the evidence. Actually, you find out what you don't have, that you can manage with other partners in the testing and inspection industry, like an Asian inspection or a VE or a TUV or Intertech, whoever. Something is missing, and probably you need some additional test or chemical risk assessment. Right? One expert tip. I showed you the example of Tukas in Finland that discovered faulty products. And you know, in many businesses there's low-hanging fruit. Low-hanging fruit is easy to catch, it tastes well. It's market surveillance authorities also have their own low-hanging fruit. It's proven that in 70% of the cases where the markings and labeling on the outside of the product are chaos, inconsistent, full with errors, language errors, font size errors, self-invented logo errors. 70%, 7 out of 10, something wrong on the outside means something wrong on the inside. That's easy low-hanging fruit for market surveillance authorities. It makes sense. If a company that's selling similar products under their brand cannot manage the packaging, that means there's a lack of structure. It's like the not-so-clean toilet in a factory. If you cannot manage those simple things, if you have not a structure, even to keep track of standardized logos, font sizes, even for that in your own brand, what will be the level of organization of the information behind it? So if you look at those news messages, we found 300 products and all 300 wrong. That's not really random sampling. Normally if you find 300 products, 70% should be wrong. But they never tell you what's right. They're not a laboratory, they're not testing the market to say, we found that it's all right. Last Friday in Holland, the market surveillance authorities issued a press conference, or a press release. They checked 30 Hoover ports all across the market, and they were all faulty. And not a little bit, very faulty. There's no overcharging protection on the batteries. The chargers didn't stop by charging, there was poor workmanship. And this probably means that this buying season in Europe around Hoover boards and similar products will not be so cheerful. Because this will, you know, if you check one brand, one mark of one supplier, probably the same principle has been applied to that product for others. If it's a power bank in a Hoover board or a battery in an automatic skateboard or electrical bicycle, it's probably similar problems. That was the same in 2015. It was the same in 2016, same in 2017. I think they fed up, really fed up. In Holland, we have around 40 fires a day in houses due to faulty batteries. And that's a country with 50 million people. It's a lot. It's more actually than fires due to people smoking a cigarette and falling asleep. Learn from the market. Now, where to look for? Just learn for the market. How to sell products? Learn for the market. Go to these websites. RAPEX is the non-food consumer goods website in Europe, where every week you see flaws. You know, it's not only always somebody did that on purpose. You know, the world is changing. You could look at these and think, okay, this could happen to my product. How could I prevent it? Which questions should I ask? Do I ask these questions? Like what you said in your previous meeting, put those questions in a structure. Put them on a list, take them with them the next visit to the factory and see what is the status of answer and keep them moving. Not moving is a risk. The other one is the RASFF, which is the food contact materials. It's a similar website. Don't look on the RASFF if you still want to eat or just have eaten. Keep your stomach some time. You'll be surprised, it's not always made in China, which is the flaw. China have nothing to do with it. You buy products, but you're not checking if what you got is the same as you ordered. Then somebody will give you what they want. Keep some margin for myself. So have a look at this and probably be surprised what is on there. Tattoo ink is very popular. Cosmetics, very popular. It's very easy to make something that look like a white cream in a very expensive box, which is not really cosmetics. Children apparel, week-on-week. It's important because it is what the market authorities see. So if you are in a high-risk product, have a look at that. Keep also track on us. Happy to answer your questions today, or if they come up tomorrow or next week, just contact us. I think you can download the presentation from the website, right? Global Sources website, Mickey?
Yeah, Facebook.
You send it later. All right. So you can look on this now. Ask me any questions now.
Thank you, Casper. Is there anyone who would like to ask Casper questions?
Sorry?
When does regulation apply after Brexit?
They will still apply after Brexit, but the question is, how do they apply to the companies in the UK? They will be a non-EU company, probably. Or they will make a deal like they have done with Norway, Switzerland, like a bilateral recognition, and that's more likely. I cannot foresee that England will step out of the whole CE regime. It's very difficult to afford setting up your whole standardization again if you tear it down and put it in the hands of Senelec and this kind of organization. So I bet it will be similar like Norway, which is not in the EU, but recognized CE, Switzerland, similar-ish. It is probably also necessary, because if it could ship to England first, and then you need to distribute them from there into Europe, like in Malta, for example, then it will be too cumbersome to set up their own framework. So there will be some kind of a mutual recognition. I can foresee that maybe for North America as well, on IT equipment. You know, if you have a laptop, you're not worried about certification bringing a laptop to Hong Kong. The laptop doesn't know it's in Hong Kong or Holland. You know, Wi-Fi is Wi-Fi. Charging a product is charging a product. And you see those modern standards like the 950 group of standards, which is already adapted for IT equipment, is almost the same for all kind of products. There's word that England might want to set up their own reach, which I feel would not be so smart. You know, if you want to arrange your own chemical legislation framework for such a small economy compared to the effort, I don't think it makes any sense. It's a good question. From Europe to England, it will change as well. But I think some companies will say it's not worth the effort. Sometimes, because it's paperwork and it doesn't change anything to the product or the margins, why fill in forms again? But some probably will say, okay, this is my opportunity. I'm good in paperwork and start doing it. Some people change, but I think it will be mutual recognition of compliance efforts. Yeah.
Thank you.
You have a good question.
Is there any more questions
for
the floor,
Brian? Yeah, Casper. So, imagine you're buying a range of products from a supplier.
Yes.
But they're all similar. Say, action cameras. But maybe there's four or five different models within that range. Maybe different sizes, different specs, what have you. Would you have to do individual testing for each one of those within that range?
No, not necessarily.
Just one would be sufficient.
Right. Coming from one supplier.
Yeah.
It would be one family of products, one file.
Oh, okay.
Sure.
Very good.
Sure.
So, what about for subsequent orders? So, you test one time, everything passed, together, you technical file of everything.
Yeah.
And you reorder a year.
Right.
Is that okay, or do you have to do all over again?
Everybody likes reorders. you need to distinguish two things. The first one is your type testing. Is the design actually in line with risk in the market? So you test the product against the appropriate standard. It might be a standard for a coffee maker or a lamp or a power bank. As long as that standard doesn't change and you didn't change the design, your basic design matches the risk of using the product in the market. After all, you're not worried about spilling water on a coffee machine or leaving it on and let it boil dry when you go home, because that's what people do. Spilling water and forgetting the product. So these intrinsic risks of the product are in the standard. Now, you're looking at the time, the deviation in time, what is happening with mass production over time. So, you're probably going to monitor A, the products produced, how are they matching the original product testing? Are they still using the same critical components that are in the original file? Workmanship, obviously. Function, government doesn't care. If you can sell coffee makers that make lousy products, lousy coffee, you're a good salesman. They don't really care. One of the things that is changing is chemical legislation. So it doesn't influence the design, but maybe affect the colorant you choose to color your plastic. This is a minor modification. It probably doesn't require a full test. You just keep track of the modification in your file. You don't need to resubmit. I say as a comparison, you have an E27 lamp holder, and you had it made out of Bakelite, and you put in a very modern LED bulb in it. That functions perfectly. So, would you have changed the Bakelite technical file in all these years? No, because REACH, don't worry about Bakelite. But the moment it would be some kind of product where you have pox in there, and suddenly something has changed because that substances and skin contact becomes a risk. That is actually the thing what we see most. Look at things that are changing while the intrinsic design is not changing. Chemicals, and probably energy regulation, eco design, like standby currents. You know, the coffee maker is still the same, but need to switch off. Those are actually the variations in time. So limited tracking and testing, inspections and testing of mass production is required, but not of new full tests. We see that a lot in the market, that people actually don't keep track of shipments. I say we don't keep track of shipments because we ask a full retest every 2 years, which is a waste of money. You know, they don't invent new electrons in CERN in Switzerland. So electrons will pass through air 1,000-fold, 1 millimeter. As long as that they don't change, why you want to do a full retest? So, but if you want to spend your budget, spend it on putting a lock on the door, inspections, audits, keeping track of what actually is made and compare it with what was originally tested. Right?
All right, great, thanks.
Thank you, Kessler. Sam, any more questions from the floor? Once again, thank you, Kessler.
You're welcome.
Please be seated. Let's give him a look.